فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. I request from the brothers inshallah ta'ala who sit in the back, if you can come forward inshallah ta'ala. Let's fill all of the gaps. Let's come as close as we can to each other. So let's not leave no gaps. Let's fill up all of the spaces. Come forward inshallah ta'ala. Come as close as you can to each other inshallah ta'ala. Okay, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to be going through Kitab Sahih al-Bukhari, not all of it, but what I will be going through inshallah ta'ala is a particular chapter of Sahih al-Bukhari, which is known as Kitab al-Iman, the chapter of al-Iman. I want to inshallah ta'ala say before I start that these classes are going to be very intense. As you can see from the schedule and the timetable, we're going to be trying to finish roughly 58 hadith in one sit, or more like in one day. And that's one part that's going to be hard for all of you guys to take in. I, as an individual, I'm used to that. The second thing, inshallah ta'ala, is that the information I give are going to be so much that some of you may feel like you don't understand, but try, inshallah ta'ala, not to give up. And but if you don't understand anything, then inshallah ta'ala, I'm hoping so that the brothers can open the floor later for any questions regarding the class. Nothing outside it. Just what we went through, inshallah ta'ala, that you might not have understood. I also ask brothers is that you bring pens and papers with you. Not just for this session, but also for all the classes that are going to be taking on Saturday and Sunday, that you have a pen and paper. Because brothers, as the ulama used to say, قَيِّدُ الْعِلْمَ بِالْكِتَابَةِ. You have to restrict, you have to narrow knowledge down with a pen. The poet, what did he say? He said, وَمِنَ الْحَمَاقَةِ أَن تَسِيلَ غَزَالَةً وَمِنَ الْحَمَاقَةِ أَن تَصِيدَ غَزَالَةً وَتَتْرُكْهَا بَيْنَ الْخَلَائِقِ طَالِقَةً. What is dimwittedness is that you actually hunt a deer, you got the deer, but then you don't tie the deer, so you just let it go out. That's how knowledge is all these information are coming to you. If you don't get your pen out, which is the rope, and you don't tie it down, meaning you don't restrict it and you don't put it into paper and pen, my beloved brothers and sisters, these things will go. And Allah says in the Quran, the first verses that came down, what was it? اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم. So the pen, my beloved brothers and sisters, is the first things we were taught. So write. You're going to hear information. Note it down. Unless, there's always an exception, unless you're like Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, and that your memorization is profound and you're strong. As soon as I say it, it just goes into your heart and you've memorized it. Then I, inshallah ta'ala, I think you should be doing the class instead of me. My beloved brothers and sisters, I'm not going to go through the life of Imam al-Bukhari, because I personally believe truly, his life is more than just a day's session. It could be months. And I'm not exaggerating if I say it could be a year. Just focusing on his life and taking benefits from him. He's an amazing individual, rahimahullah. So I'm not going to go through him. The second reason why I'm not going to go through his life is because he's ghani. He's very rich. Rich in the sense where we all know him. We all know who he is. But I'm going to, inshallah ta'ala, give you guys a quick summary, khulasa, of the book. This book that we're going to go through. Ikhwani, this book we're going to go through, inshallah ta'ala, is known as what? What's the name of this book that we're going to go through? Many of you might answer right now and say, it's Sahih al-Bukhari, but that's not the name the author called it. And Imam al-Bukhari did not call this book of his Sahih al-Bukhari, he didn't call it Sahih al-Bukhari. And it's sometimes sad when you look at the situation of the Muslims and you see, they don't even know the most authentic book after the book of Allah. They don't even know the full name for it. What did Al-Imam Al-Araqi rahimahullah say? He says, وَأَوَّلُ مَنْ صَنَّفَ فِي الصَّحِيحِ مُحَمَّدٌ وَخُسَّ بِالتَّرْجِيحِ وَمُسْلِمٌ بَعْدُ وَبَعْدُ الْغَرْبِ مَعْ أَبِي عَلِيٍّ فَضَّلُوا ذَا لَوْ نَفَعْ وَلَمْ يَعُمَّاهُ وَلَكِنْ قَلَّمَا عِنْدَ ابْنِ الْأَخْرَمِ مِنْهُ قَدْ فَاتَهُمَا وَرُدَّ لَكِنْ قَالَ يَحْيَى الْبَرُّ لَمْ يَفُتِ الْخَمْسَةَ إِلَّا النَّزْرُ وَفِيهِ مَا فِيهِ لِقَوْلِ الْجُعْفِي أَحْفَظُ مِنْهُ عُشْرَ أَلْفِ أَلْفِ أَوَّلُ مَنْ صَنَّفَ فِي الصَّحِيحِ The first person who ever authored an authentic book, the first person, and we're talking about after the book of Allah, is who? Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Bukhari's distinct characteristics was, before him, Ibn Jurayj came, and Abdullah ibn Mubarak, Al-Imam al-Awza'i, Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas, rahimahullah, all of those scholars, they came. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Pay attention. Ibn Jurayj came, he authored a book of hadith before Bukhari. Al-Imam Malik, he wrote his famous book, which is known as what? Muwatta Imam Malik, right? Did he not? He did. Al-Imam Malik came and he wrote his Muwatta. Al-Ibn Jurayj came, he wrote a book. Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, he also wrote a book. Al-Awza'i wrote a book of hadith. Imam Ahmad came before Imam al-Bukhari, he also wrote a book of hadith. But the one thing they all did not do, that only Bukhari did, was what? Condition? Authenticity. They all did it condition authenticity. Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullah, in his Muwatta, he did it condition authenticity. Some of you might say to yourselves, but what about the statement of Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i where he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ تَحْتَ أَدِيمِ السَّمَاءِ كِتَابٌ أَصَحُ مِنْ مُوَطَّئِ مَالِكِ Al-Imam Anas, Imam Shafi'i said, I have never seen a book more authentic than the book of Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas. This is Shafi'i saying this. So how do we reconcile between Shafi'i's statement here saying that the most authentic book is Muwatta Imam Malik and the statement of you now saying that the most authentic book after the book of Allah is Bukhari? How do we reconcile between the two? It's very simple to reconcile it. Shafi'i didn't see Sahih al-Bukhari. And Imam Shafi'i was before Bukhari. And Shafi'i is talking about what was authored at his time. Okay? The time that Imam Shafi'i existed, the best book out there was Muwatta Imam Malik. But then when Bukhari came, he conditioned authenticity. And that's why he named his book Al-Jami' Al-Musnad Al-Sahih Al-Mukhtasar Min Sunan Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam Wa Ayyamih. That's what he called it. So now from the name we're going to learn a very powerful point. Al-Jami' If you look at the ways that the books of hadith are written, is in many different ways. Some of the books of hadith are known as Kutub Al-Ahkam. They only deal with ahadith pertaining to fiqh issues, such as the book Sunan Abi Dawood. It's a kitab which is named as Sunan. Why is it called a Sunan? Because it deals with ahadiths that are fiqh issue related. So all the ahadiths that you read from Sunan Abi Dawood are going to be ahadiths pertaining to fiqh related matters. So that's one way that scholars write books. Also books like that are, Sunan Tirmidhi and Sunan Ibn Majah and Sunan Al-Nisa'i and others. Even that Imam Tirmidhi is differed upon. Does that make sense, my beloved brothers and sisters? The second way that the scholars write their books of hadith is known as what? Ajza. Ajza. What does ajza mean? Scholars will write a particular topic, they will bring all the narrations pertaining to that. Such as Imam al-Bukhari, he wrote a book called Juz fi raf' al-yadayni. The Juz only deals with the lifting of the hands in the salah. Or Juz fi qira'ati khalf al-imam. Juz, a particular hadith which only deals with reciting behind the imam, whether the Fatiha, you have to recite it after the imam, in the salah, which are jahriya. Also these ahadith books that are written on ajza, shuyukh mu'tabareen, ama shuyukh, specific books, a juz is only written on particular shuyukhs. So a scholar will come, and he'll write all the narrations of a particular individual, and he'll write it in a way. In all that book. This book is only, مثلاً, the riwayat of Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn, Amma, the riwayat of so-and-so. Does that make sense? This is a juz. The next other way that is written as well is known as masanid, musnad. Ahadith which are masanid are ahadith which deal with companions and they bring each companion in a particular place. For example, if you go to the kitab Musnad Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and you want to find a hadith that was narrated by al-imam, brothers, pay attention, inshallah ta'ala. Books are written, like Masanid, Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, are books that deal with every companion by itself, separately. For example, Muslim Imam Ahmad, you open it, the first ahadith are all the hadiths of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And then second comes Umar ibn al-Khattab. And then Uthman ibn Affan. And then Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ashar al-Mubashareena bil Jannah. The 10 that were promised Jannah, they come first. So he put them in that order. And Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. So you won't find in maybe, for instance, the third or fourth or fifth volume, you won't find the narrations of Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr is already in the first volume. Does that make sense, brothers? Those are known as Masanid Musnads. The one that now concerns us is, okay, and there are many other ways, but the one that concerns us today is the one that's known as Jami'. And that's the name of the book. Imam Bukhari named his book. He called it Al-Jami'. You know why he called it Jami'? It's because it's comprehensive. يَجِمَعُ شُطُوتَ الْفُنُونَ. Many different funun. It deals with, for example, raqa'iq, heart softening. It deals with tawheed. It deals with ahkam even. It deals with qisas, stories. It talks about virtues and manaqib. It talks about, does that make sense? That book is jami'. It's comprehensive. It doesn't specify itself in a particular field of the religion. And Imam Bukhari's book is like this. So that's the first title of the name. So it's called Al-Jami'. And then it's called Al-Musnad. Musnad means every narration Imam al-Bukhari is going to bring it from himself and he's going to attribute to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So for example, he's going to say Hadathan al-Humaydi, Abdullah ibn Zubayrin, Hadathan, and he goes to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And we're going to see that inshallah ta'ala today bi-idhnillahi al-kareem, this issue of narration. And this is important because we have to understand the importance of asanid and chains of narration. As Abdullah ibn Mubarak said, and Muhammad ibn Sirin was also narrated from him, where he said, Al-Isnadu min ad-Dini walawla al-Isnadu laqala man sha'a ma sha'a. The chain is your religion. And if it wasn't for the chain, everybody would have claimed whatever they wanted. Al-Isnadu min ad-Dini walawla al-Isnadu laqala man sha'a ma sha'a. If it wasn't for the chain, and this is the unique thing that this ummah has over all of the other nations, is that we have chains from ourselves to the Prophet ﷺ. Everything we have with the naqal is transmitted to us, authentication. Okay? And the poet Hafidh al-Hakami says about when he spoke about فَسُنَّةُ النَّبِيِّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ عَلَيْهِمَا قَدْ أُطْلِقَ الْوَحْيَانِ وَإِنَّمَا طَرِيقُهَا الرِّوَايَةَ فَافْتَقَرَ الرَّاوِي إِلَى الدِّرَايَةَ. Until he says فَمَيَّزُوا صَحِيحَهَا مِنْ مُفْتَرَى حَتَّى صَفَتْ دَقِيَّةً كَمَا تَرَى. فَمَيَّزُوا. The scholars of hadith, they came, they distinguished all the narrations from one another, they organized it and they made sure its authenticity is there. How did they organize it and how did they work on it? They worked on it by making sure that it's by bringing it through chains of narrations. And each individual's chain is authentically checked up and it's looked on. Brothers, I told you this is a lot of information that's going to be taken. So you have to be patient, inshallah ta'ala. لا ينال العلم براحة الجسد. لا ينال العلم براحة الجسد. As Yahya ibn Abi Kathir said, Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim brought it in his Sahih Mu'allaqan, that you will not gain knowledge with a relaxed body. You have to put yourself through hardship. So pay attention to these information, inshallah ta'ala. As I said to you, you have to have a pen and paper, and don't rely on these recordings. Don't rely on these things. Note any information that I mentioned, and if you have questions asked after, inshallah ta'ala, we will mention them. So Imam al-Bukhari's kitab is called Al-Jami'. We mentioned that. And then it's called Al-Musnad. We explained what it means. And then we said it's called Al-Mukhtasar, summarized. Okay? Al-Mukhtasar means summarized. Why would we say it's summarized? لأن الإمام البخاري لم يشترط على نفسي. And Imam al-Bukhari did not condition on himself to bring all the narrations that are authentic on the face of this earth. No. No, he didn't. So he only summarized himself and he narrowed himself down on some of the ahadith which are authentic. He didn't say, I'm going to bring every hadith which is authentic on the face of this earth. Are you with me? وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ الْعِرَاقِيُّ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ refuted before him Ibn Salah did, and also Sakhawi extended more explanation on his kitab Fath al-Mughith, which is the sharah of Alfiyatul Iraqi, that whoever says that the six books of hadith, if you want the whole religion, it's in these six books of hadith, then they are not right or they're not accurate in that statement. Because there are many other ahkam that you will not find in the six books of hadith. Okay, my beloved brothers and sisters, and that are authentic. So to say that Bukhari narrated all the authentic ahadith is wrong. Are you with me? It's wrong to say that. Rather, to even say that all the authentic ahadith are in the six books of hadith are also wrong. Does that make sense? There are many ahadith which are found in Musnad Imam Ahmad, they're also, or which is part of the six anyways, but found in Musnad al-Tayalisi مثلاً, that are sahih, that you won't find in the six books of hadith. You'll find ahadith which are sahih, that you find in Mu'jam al-Tabarani, al-Kubra, al-Sughra, and wal-Wusta. Does that make sense? You find ahadith which are authentic that you don't find in the Ummahatu Sitta, that you will find in Musannaf Abdul Razak ibn Hammam al-San'ari, or the Musannaf ibn Abi Shayba, rahimahumullahu jami'an. So the book is called Al-Jami' As al-Musnad Al-Mukhtasar, and then As-Sahih. Sahih means what? So the definition of Sahih is وهو ما اتصل إسناده ولم يشد أو يعل يرويه عدل ضابط عن مثله معتمد في ضبطه ونقله. It is any hadith that fulfills three conditions and two things are missing from it. Is that the chain of narration is connected, okay? Is تسلسل الروات. The second one is that the narrators are tam al-dabt, their memorization is accurate. Second thing is that their integrity is high. And also two things are absent. And the two things that are absent are, there's no opposition of this narration to any other narration. And the third, last one, but not least, is that there is not illatun qadihatul fatudi. There is no defect in the narration that's hidden. Okay? So then the hadith becomes sahih. So al-imam, and then he says, min sunan al-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ayyami, and that's just an explanation of what it means, al-musnad. So that's the actual name of Sahih al-Bukhari that you now today need to memorize. The author of this book, his name is called Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ibrahim ibn Ismail ibn Mughira al-Bardizba. He's from, today if you accurately look at the land that he's from Uzbekistan. Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah. So he wasn't even an Arab. وَلِذَلِكَ from the six scholars of hadith that writ, are you with me? The Ummahatu Sita, there's only two people, the only two that are Arab. The rest are not. From the six books of hadith. The first one is Imam Muslim, rahimahullah. And some scholars, they said, no, Imam Muslim is not even an Arab. But the strongest is that it is an Arab. That's what Imam al-Sakhawi strengthened in his kitab, Ghunyatul Muhtaj. Ghunyatul Muhtaj. Imam al-Sakhawi strengthened that opinion that Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, is an Arab. And that is correct. Second person is Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah. Imam al-Tirmidhi is an Arab. The rest of the four remaining are not Arab. So you can see this issue of who protects the religion and who honors the religion and who safeguards the religion and who can defend. It doesn't necessarily have to be an Arab. And this religion can come through. And these people, if you look at them today, the countries that they are from are Persian and Russia and, you know, up Chinese. Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah, today his eyes would be very small. He would look, and you can look at the people of Uzbekistan. They look Chinese. Huh? That's the type of people he was from. Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah. And he was, Bukhari rahimahullah, he is, as the scholars call him, Amirul Mu'mineen fil Hadith. He's Amirul Mu'mineen fil Hadith. وَلِذَلِكَ Ibn Khaldun rahimahullah, he said, صَحِحُ الْبُخَارِيُ دَيْنٌ عَلَى هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. That صَحِحُ الْبُخَارِيُ is a debt on this ummah that they need to pay back. Then Al-Imam al-Sakhawi came, who is the student of Hafidh ibn Hajar, and he said, in response to Ibn Khaldun's statement, he said, لَوْ رَأَ ابْنُ خَلْدُونٍ مَا صَنَعَهُ ابْنُ حَجَرٍ لَرَأَ أَنَّ دَيْنَ تُوفِيَ حَقَّ الْوَفَاءِ. Al-Imam al-Sakhawi said that if Ibn Khaldun was to see what Ibn Hajar did in explaining Sahih al-Bukhari, he would have realized that the debt has been paid off for us. Al-Imam al-Bukhari Ibn Hajar fulfilled that debt from us. He paid it on our behalf. Why did he? Because he put the best explanation on Sahih al-Bukhari. Now, brothers, Al-Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, rahimahullah, he has written a book called Hadyu al-Sari, which is the Muqaddimah of Fathul Bari. It's also read as Huda al-Sari. Both ways you can say it. Hadyu al-Sari ama Huda al-Sari. It's a Muqaddimah of Sahih al-Bukhari. It's an introduction before you read Sahih al-Bukhari. If you want to know about this book, you read that book. And that book is two volumes. Okay, can I summarize that in one sit? Or even 124 hours? Nah, I won't be able to. And Ibn Hajar was writing that for how many years? 16 years. 16 years Ibn Hajar was writing the introduction to what? The introduction to Sahih al-Bukhari and to have an understanding of Sahih al-Bukhari. Ibn Hajar did this. So you can imagine I can't go through all of that information right now with all of you guys. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, why did he write this book? What brought it to his mind? The scholars, they mentioned two reasons why he narrated it. Or why he wrote this book or why he authored it. The first is that Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, his teacher, Ishaq ibn Ibrahim, who's known as Ishaq ibn Rahuya, or some scholars they say Ishaq ibn Rahawiya ala sigati Sibawiya. Al-Imam Ishaq ibn Rahuya, who is the teacher of Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he brought the idea to Imam in a gathering where Bukhari was sitting. He said, if only a person came out and wrote a book that's all authentic and the hadith are all correct and authentic, it would have been something good. Bukhari was in the gathering, he heard that, and when he heard that, it hit his heart. It sunk into his heart, and my beloved brothers and sisters, he then wrote the most authentic book on the face of this earth. And this shows the aspiration of these people. Things like that will wake them up, and they would want to do something. For us, if you tell a brother, wallah, your mashallah, your memorization is actually good. You see, I can go memorize the Quran. 10 years later, if you come back, he still hasn't memorized the Quran. And the poet, he said, وَمَنْ تَكُنِ الْعِلْيَا هِمَّةَ نَفْسِهِ فَكُلُّ الَّذِي يَلْقَى فِيهِ مُحَبَّبُ. Anyone who has high aspirations, then everything he endures, whilst he's taking, trying to achieve his goal, he finds it joy. He likes it. He enjoys it. If you have high aspiration, you set yourself a goal, every pain that comes whilst you're trying to achieve that goal, you find it, you enjoy it. You don't find pain, or you don't find hardship through it. And as the poet said, وَالْعِلْمُ يَدْخُلُ قَلْبَ كُلِّ مُوَفَّقٍ مِنْ غَيْرِ بَوَّابٍ وَلَا اسْتِئِذَانِ وَيَرُدُّهُ الْمَحْرُومُ مِنْ خِذْلَانِهِ لَا تُشْقِنَ اللَّهُمَّ بِالْحِرْمَانِ. Knowledge enters the heart of every single body. There's no restriction. You can be from whatever background you want. You can be of whatever age you want. You can be from whatever particular community you want. Knowledge will enter the heart of every single person. The only person who knowledge is prohibited from is the person who comes with so many sins that they taint their hearts. So my beloved brothers and sisters, Bukhari was born only 9 months, just like you were born 9 months. He came out of the womb of his mother not knowing anything, just like you came out of the womb of your mother not knowing anything. Allah says in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ أَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا. Allah brought you out of the womb of your mothers not knowing anything. So no one had a head start. Everybody came out knowing nothing. But where Bukhari passed you and passed me and passed all of us is because he had high aspirations. And he didn't just dream. As they say, dreaming is half the bottle. But rather what he did was, he actually went after his dream. He implemented his dreams. He set himself goals, and he made sure he fulfilled those goals. So that was the first reason why Bukhari wrote his authentic book. The second reason is because they said he had a dream. And in the dream what he saw was, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, flies were coming to the Prophet's face, alayhi salatu wasalam. And Imam al-Bukhari, he had, what's it called, this thing you... Huh? A swat. Yeah, you know, you get rid of the flies. He had that. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he was getting rid of the flies, not touching the Prophet's face. So when he woke up, he asked the interpretation of this dream. He said, what is this dream that I had? And they told him, you are going to defend the Prophet's sunnah alayhi salatu wasalam, and you're going to make sure that no one comes and attributes to him that which he didn't say alayhi salatu wasalam. And this reminds me of what I read by al-Imam al-Barzali rahimahullah, Alamuddin al-Barzali rahimahullah, who min talamidati al-Imam ibn Taymiyyah. It was from the students of al-Imam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He saw Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi rahimahullah one day. He saw Imam Al-Dhahabi. Alamuddin Al-Barzali saw Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi. You guys don't know what Imam Al-Dhahabi is. The great historian and the great scholar of hadith. Barzali saw Dhahabi writing something. He saw him writing on a place. And then he looked at him. And at this particular time, Al-Imam Al-Dhahabi was into the field of qira'at, the recitations of the Qur'an and the dialects of the Qur'an. So when he saw him, he said to him, قِرَاءَةُ كِتَابَتُكَ. You're writing كِتَابَةُ أَهْلِ الْحَدِيثِ. You write like the people of hadith. Like you write like the scholars of hadith. And he looked at him and he said, really? And he said, yes. From that day onwards, Al-Imam al-Dhahabi embarked on the path of learning hadith. Allahu Akbar. Just one word like that changed their lives. So when Bukhari was told that you're going to defend the Prophet ﷺ as a hadith, it made him go forward. And it made him fulfill his dream. And it made him achieve. My beloved brothers and sisters, Allah raises these people, and the people of knowledge, Allah raises them. يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. Allah also says, أَمَّنْ هُوَ قَانِتٌ آنَاءَ اللَّيْلِ سَاجِدًا وَقَائِمًا يَحْذَرُ الْآخِرَةَ وَيَرْجُو رَحْمَةَ رَبِّهِ قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And ولذلك علي بن أبي طالب said, كَفَى بِالْعِلْمِ شَرَفًا أَنْ يَدَّعِيهِ مَنْ لَا يُحْسِنُ. Enough to show you the virtue of knowledge, it is that every single person will claim knowledge. If I said to anybody here right now, you're ignorant, he'll get angry. That's enough to show you how powerful and how good knowledge is. Everyone wants to be part of the idea of being a scholar. And to show you how low ignorance is, everyone here would not like to be attributed to ignorance. Sahih? That's enough to show you how bad and how low ignorance is, my beloved brothers and sisters. Now we have some understanding, a little bit of understanding of Sahih al-Bukhari and also the author of this book. The book that we've chosen from this big book, Sahih al-Bukhari, is a book called Kitab al-Iman. Kitab al-Iman. And this is, we chose Kitab al-Iman. Kitab al-Iman, the reason why we chose it is because Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, their fundamental principles in which they believe Allah with. Pay attention to this. Usul masaili ahli sunnati wal jama'ah. If you today go and open books of aqidah, if you look at, for example, Kitab Sharh al-Sunnah, written by Abu Qasim Hibatullahi al-Lalaka'iyu, or you look at the Kitab Al-Hujjah fi Bayan al-Mahajjah, written by Abu Qasim al-Taymiyu, or you go to the Kitab Usul al-Sunnah, written by Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Or you go to the kitab Sharh al-Sunnah, written by Yahya ibn Ismail al-Muzani. Or you go to the kitab Sarih al-Sunnah, written by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, rahimahullah. Any books of those aqidah books, if you pick them up, you will find that it revolves around these 5 points. These aqidah books, they talk about these 5 points. And from the things that they talk about is, number one, مسائل الأسماء والصفات, Allah's names and attributes. Number two, مسائل الأسماء والأحكام, rulings and names such as Al-Kufru wal-Imanu. You find them present in the books of Aqidah. That's the second thing they talk about. مسائل الأسماء والأحكام. The third thing that they talk about is مسائل القضاء والقدر, issues pertaining to قضاء والقدر. The third thing which they talk about, fourth thing that they talk about, is known as مسائل الوعد والوعيد, مرتكب الكبيرة, the person who does a major sin, how should we deal with him. Last but not least, which is the fifth one, they talk about مسائل الصحابة, the matters pertaining to the companions, and they refute the Nasibiyah and also the Rawafid, who went against أهل السنة والجماعة in the issue pertaining to the companions of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And those five, one of them, مسائل الأسماء والأحكام, is the issue of Iman. And so we thought, since it is the most authentic book after the book of Allah, what is better than actually going to Sahih al-Bukhari and studying مسائل الأسماء والأحكام straight from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his own tongue, alayhi salatu wasalam. Iman, my beloved brothers and sisters, is an issue which Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, as you always know, as Allah says in the Quran, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. Allah has made us a nation who are in the middle. We are not Ahlul Ifrat, or we're not also Ahlul Tafrit. We're not Ahlul Ifrat, we don't go overboard, and we don't also come short. We're not extreme, and we're not negligent. Okay, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah are also always in the middle. Just like Islam is in the middle of all religions. Islam is in the middle of all religions. And Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah within Islam, they are in the middle from all of the deviated groups. And how are they? You're going to see. This issue of Iman, we're going to inshallah ta'ala speak about it from defining it linguistically, and then we're going to define it technically, and then inshallah ta'ala we're going to go into the narrations bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. First of all, before I go in, Al-Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, and also we're going to compare Bukhari with Sahih Muslim. We're going to compare Bukhari with Sahih Muslim. And this is something you have to understand. When scholars, they place in their books, Kitabul Iman, just like Imam Muslim rahimahullah did. He placed a book called Kitabul Iman. Rather, Imam Muslim, he started his book with Kitabul Iman. Whereas Imam Bukhari, he started his book with what? Kitabu Bad'il Wahi, the revelation coming down. That's what Imam Bukhari started his book with. And then the second chapter he made it was what? After seven narrations in Kitab al-Bad' al-Wahi, he brought Kitab al-Iman. So he made it the second. Whereas Imam Muslim, he made it what? He made it the first one. Now, let's compare the two. Al-Imam Muslim's way he brought Kitab al-Iman is that he brought Kitab al-Iman ala itlaqihi al-am, in its general usage. Okay, what do I mean by the general usage? Al-Imam Muslim's Kitab al-Iman is not like the Kitab al-Iman of Al-Imam al-Bukhari. Because Al-Imam Muslim is talking about أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خيره وشره. And he brings the famous hadith of Jibreel, بينما نحن جلوس عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم اطلع علينا رجل شديد بياض الثياب شديد السواد الشعر لا يرى عليه أثر سفر ولا يعرفه منا أحد حتى جلس إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأسند ركبتيه إلى ركبتيه ووضع كفيه على فخذيه وقال يا محمد أخبرني عن الإسلام قال الإسلام أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. Bukhari brings it in hadith Umar ibn Khattab, whereas Al-Imam Bukhari and Muslim, both of them, they brought it in hadith Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. May Allah be pleased with Bukhari, Umar ibn Khattab, and also Abu Huraira. This hadith teaches us, when the Prophet asked Islam and he was told, what did Jibreel say to him? قال صدقت فعجبنا له يسأله ويصدقه. Jibreel said, you told the truth. Then the companions, they said, we were fascinated. He asks him a question, the Prophet answers the question, and then he goes to the Prophet, you're right. How could that be unless he knew the answer? So that was a shocking thing to the companions. Then he said, قال فأخبرني عن الإيمان. قال الإيمان أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خير وشر. So Imam Muslim started Kitab al-Iman with Hadith Jibreel that you all know. And then of course he goes to, قال فأخبرني عن الإحسان. قال أن أن تعبد الله كأنك ترى فإن لم تكن ترى فإنه يراك قال فأخبرني عن الساعة قال ما المسؤول عنها بأعلم من السائل قال فأخبرني عن أماراتها قال أن تلد الأمة ربتها وأن ترى الحفاة العراة العالة رعاء الشاء يتطاولون في البنيان ثم انطلقت فلبثت مليا قال عمر بن سيد قال فإن قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بروفيسة عمر قال فإنه جبريل أتاكم يعلمكم دينكم. So from this hadith we learn that Imam Muslim started his first hadith in Kitab al-Iman to speak about the six articles of faith. So that's the general usage of Iman. Whereas Imam Bukhari, no. Bukhari wants to speak about the issue of Iman from the angle of what? Musamma al-Iman. What does Iman actually mean? And Imam al-Bukhari is trying to refute three deviated groups. The first one is Al-Khawarij. The second one is the Murji'a. And the third one is the Mu'tazila. So he's using it, Itlaqul Khas. So Imam Muslim is speaking about the six articles of faith. And he's going to go in there and he's going to bring those evidences for it. Whereas in Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah, he wants to talk about what does Iman actually mean? And where did Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah and all the other deviate groups, where did they separate with one another? Now we're going to go into the issue of Al-Iman. Al-Iman, my beloved brothers and sisters, is... As Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah mentions in his kitab As-Sarim al-Munki fi al-Radd ala al-Subki, and he mentions in his kitab Mujmal i'tiqad ahli sunnah wal jama'ah, and he also mentions in the 8th volume of his kitab Majmu' al-Fatawa, and also in his Majam' al-Masail. Also Ibn Manda rahimahullah in kitab al-Iman, also Muhammad Nasr al-Marwazi in his kitab Ta'zim qadr al-Salah. All of those scholars, they mentioned that Iman is, there are many usage it has come in, but from the strongest that we're going to take is that Iman is linguistically al-iqrar. Al-iqrar. Some scholars, they say that the Iman linguistically means at-tasdiq. Ibn Taymiyyah proved that Iman lughatan, it is not tasdiq. And he mentioned it from four different angles that it can't be. Four different angles Ibn Taymiyyah proves that Iman linguistically cannot be tasdiq. What does tasdiq mean? It's to believe. Ibn Taymiyyah says, no, it's not. But some scholars also came after Ibn Taymiyyah, فَعَقَّبُوا عَلَى Ibn Taymiyyah. They also put it on Ibn Taymiyyah in the sense where they said maybe there's a way to reconcile between your belief Ibn Taymiyyah and the belief of others who've said that Iman means التصديق. And the way they reconciled it between is by saying لَيْسَ مُجَرَّدِ التَّصْدِيقِ. It's not just a mere tasdiq, but rather what it is that it is تَصْدِيقُ الْجَازِمِ. It's tasdiq that has in it unwavering conviction. Well, even then, if you still look at that statement of that person, it could still be said that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah may not have agreed with that. Because the kalimat al-tasdiq fi lugha is not like iman fi lugha. Do you know why? Because al-iman tata'adda bimaf'oolin, and that is two things. The word iman is a transitive verb. If you say amana, it's a transitive verb. It transits with one of two. For example, the Arabs would say, قوله تعالى, amana al-rasulu bima. And it uses the ba to transit into the maf'ul. Okay? And also it sometimes uses lam. فَآمَنَ لَهُ لُوطَ. Lam is used. So those are the two usages. And he said, as for tasdiq, فَإِنَّهَا تَتَعَدَّى بِنَفْسِهَا. It doesn't, لَا تَتَعَدَّى بِغَيْرِهَا. It doesn't transit through a article. But rather, the tasdiq, it goes through to its maf'ul directly through itself. So he said, even lughatan, it is wrong for it to be used. And he mentions many other different reasons why he believes, rahimahullah. From another reasons why he mentions is that the opposite to tasdiq is takdeeb, lie. So if somebody tells you the truth, you say, you told me the truth. If he didn't tell you the truth, you say, you lied to me. As for iman, the opposite to it is not tasdiq, it's not takdeeb only. Rather, juhud can be the opposite of iman. Are you with me, brothers? And iba can be also the all of those. So Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah wants, rahimahullah, to prove that is not the usage. Are you with me? So now let's go into the issue of Iman. Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, three arkan, three pillars. And I'm going to ask you this question, inshallah ta'ala, bi-ithnillahi al-kareem. If you guys want to believe in the issue of Al-Iman, three things have to be intact for you to be according to Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah in the issue of Musamma al-Iman. The first point is that Al-Imanu qawlun wa amal. The second point is Al-Imanu yazidu bil-ta'ati wa yanqusu bil-ma'asiyah. Third thing is Al-Istithna fil-Iman. And it is not laysa bi'tibari aslihi. Let's go back to the first point. The first point is Al-Imanu qawlun wa amal. That Iman is speech and action. The qawl, the scholars, they bring two out of it. Qawlul lisan and qawlul qalb. Amal, they bring two out of it. Amalul qalbi and amalul jawarih. And there's one hadith that summarizes each and every one of those. Hadith of Abu Huraira, which is found in As-Sahihain. Al-Imanu bid'un wa sittuna shu'ba. It's also narrated as Al-Imanu bid'un وسبعون شعبة أعلاها قول لا إله إلا الله وأدناها إماطة الأذى عن الطريق والحياء شعبة من شعب الإيمان. The Prophet said this عليه الصلاة والسلام. This hadith teaches us that the iman is what? قول عمل. And that the قول is two types. The قول of the tongue and the قول of the heart. What's the قول of the tongue? النطق بالشهادتين. The person has to utter the شهادتين. When he comes into Islam, he has to say أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. The second one is عمل. قول القلب. قول القلب is إقرار. قول القلب is إقرار and تصديق. The third one is, so we finished قول now. قول اللسان is two. How much is it? قول, the speech of the tongue, the utterance of the tongue, and the utterance of the heart. The second two is عمل. عمل القلب, which is المحبة والإخلاص والتوكل والرغبة والرهبة والإنابة, all of those. And عمل الجوارح is الصلاة والصيام والصوم والحج. And also the other branches. So أهل السنة والجماعة, how did they go against? Pay attention to this. This is a very powerful point. Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, how did they go against the deviated groups?